Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Alex Jung, and I'm last. And I think I'm last because I am the accountant in the room. I actually am a partner with Ernst & Young. We are now called EY. And what I do for a living and for the last 30 years is to work with Fortune 500 companies, private equity, venture capital, and other types of investors when they're looking for assets. I specialize in transactions, mergers and acquisitions, and I have a lot of clients that are looking for companies like yours to add to their portfolio. Sometimes they call me and they say, hey, I'm looking for this asset and I need something in 48 hours. They think I'm a real estate broker and there's all kinds of stuff available in the market. So I've learned a lot today and I've met a lot of you already, and it was intriguing to see what is in the pipeline from an innovation standpoint. But I will tell you, one of the challenges we have as an accounting firm is we're responsible for doing what's called diligence. They hire people like me, forensic accountants and other types of professionals, attorneys, patent lawyers, to evaluate these assets. And I can't tell you in the 30 years that I've been doing this how many companies I've heard say we're worth $1 billion. The reality is that you have to have some rigor and discipline around the valuation of the benefit that can be derived from adding a portfolio company, especially if you're a large Fortune 500 publicly traded corporation. So when we do diligence, we not only look at the commercial viability, which is important. You know, you guys all talk about addressable market, you talk about potential revenue. We also look at competition, and we look at positioning, and we look at the ability to commercialize the product and scale it. So many of you are facing those challenges today. And what we're going to talk about in this session is, how do you bring your products to market with continued investment? Who are the right partners? And what do you do with philanthropy? A couple of years ago, there was a book written by Malcolm Gladwell, and there were three archetypes that he talks about in that book. One of them is the maven. The maven is the person who has the idea. There's lots of mavens in this room today. The other one is the connector. These are the people who connect individuals. I'm a little bit of a connector. I get you in touch with investors, you tell me what your portfolio product is. And then the last one is the salesperson. And there's been a few salespeople at the podium today who've done a nice job illustrating the value of their company. But what we're going to talk about on this panel is, how do you demonstrate that value? Where is this investment going to come from? There's lots and lots of diversity in this space, and there's lots of interest in it. So with that, I'm going to let my panelists introduce themselves, and then we're going to come back and have a little discussion. So let's start with Joan.
All right, so, I mean, obviously, if you don't know who I am yet, I am Joan Koerber-Walker, and I'm the CEO and president of AZBio. What some people don't realize is I've actually been an investor, both as an angel investor and a private equity investor, since 1987, and in life sciences since 1997. And before you all come up to me when we go to the bar, when I took the job at AZBio, I stopped investing in startup companies in Arizona for the simple reason that I can't invest in all of you. So I stopped. But I will tell you that when you go public, I will be one of the very first people to buy that stock and support you in that way. But as we go forward, I think it's really important that we have the conversation not just about, you know, what we have as innovators, but what we need to get that innovation to the marketplace, because if it doesn't get to market, it doesn't get to patients.
Well, my name's Jim Brewer, and I'm the executive director for the Arizona chapter of the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society. And they say in life, the timing is everything, and I'm so glad to be one of the only things between you and happy hour. So I will hopefully keep this light and moving as far as my part of it. I guess, for lack of a better word, I'm kind of the white hat in the room, in that I represent a nonprofit voluntary health agency that invests in innovation and helps, actually, to Alex's point, connect a lot of the players in the innovation ecosystem that are all around. For us, it's blood cancer research that almost always then becomes relevant to other types of cancer. But one of the things that we've done at LLS has taken an innovative approach to how we fund and invest in this research. And specifically, one of the programs we have is called the Therapy Acceleration program, which invests in small biotechnology companies in promising new research that they might have at a critical juncture where they might need a little bit of money to get over the hump. Maybe it's a phase one trial or even up to a phase two trial that then hopefully provides the opportunity to show the efficacy of the treatment so that it can then attract larger investment, because at least in the drug development world, we don't have the money to get a drug all the way from the bench to the bedside. That takes a lot of money and big pharma normally. And so that's what we have started doing over the last 10 years. We've invested about $100 million in different types of small biotech companies around the country. That has then attracted another $700 million of investment from larger firms to help get those innovations through the approval process and hopefully into the hands of patients. So where I sit, first of all, I'm a fundraiser. We'll start right there. What I do here within Arizona is a lot about, I'm not a maven, that's for darn sure. I am a connector, at times a salesperson, but what we really are here in raising money within Arizona through LLS is to fund these investments in research so that we can hopefully one day create a world without blood cancers.
Thank you. So let's get to the meat of this. This conversation's about money. Many of you are looking for it. People like me try to figure out who to give it to. So research that's being done in this space is growing, and my organization and other organizations have been researching the investments that are being made. In 2014, there was a study published by Tufts that indicates it takes about $2.5 billion to get a drug to market. That's a big R&D investment. In the med tech space, it could be hundreds of millions of dollars. Hundreds of millions of dollars to build infrastructure to just commercialize a product. And then maybe it's worth $3 billion. But beyond that, the other thing we do research around is to try to figure out where the value for those innovations is going to be applied. And in the future, there's different metrics that investors are going to be applying. It's not just the financial and due diligence that people like me do. It's really understanding the qualitative and societal value of those innovations. And we'll come back to that point in a minute, but I'd like to start with a question to our panelists around, if the research tells us that there's challenges, challenges in getting funding, challenges in raising money, challenges in getting capital and convincing investors, where do you think, and we'll start with you, Jim, where do you think the money's gonna come from in the future?
Well, I would love to say that as a nonprofit, that our organization and others just like it will be part of that source. And I think, again, the project I was just describing is an innovative way to do that. But if you look at $2.5 billion to bring a drug to market, and we are investing $8, $9 million at a time, that may not be realistic, I think. Obviously, there's a lot of uncertainty in the world of research funding right now to see where that money is going to come from. But I think we're starting to see, along the lines of what Alex was mentioning, this interest in the social common good around the developments that are happening right now. And so whether it's the angel investors or some of the more socially conscious investment groups that I've seen and hear pop up, finding that way to make an impact on society, I guess, as a whole, is a way for them to make their investments have that impact that goes beyond, and again, I'm the nonprofit guy, so I'm not thinking P&L very much, but goes beyond just that initial financial reward. And what are we doing to advance the cause of our patients or of people that are gonna benefit from these discoveries? And hearing the young man talk about the headband for epilepsy and how that personal experience caused him to think, how can I do something about this? Now, attracting investment around that may not be, again, not understanding market size necessarily and what that financial opportunity is, but the real opportunity to do something good for patients who are afflicted with this. I think broadening that perspective, and again, I wish it could be nonprofit organizations. We can only raise so much money, believe me, I'm doing it every day, to be able to hopefully, you know, make some good in the world and have an impact on our mission. But I think it's the people that are looking at this from a larger holistic viewpoint that might be willing to open their wallets a little bit wider if that does have that societal impact that I think a lot of people, hopefully the people with the money, are looking to make.
Joan, any comments?
So I think so often we talk about investment and we lump it in this one bucket, okay? Like, you just pour all the money in the bucket and then everybody gets to put their hand in to take what they need to take out. And the reality is that there's a whole series of buckets. And, you know, the bucket for startups, there might be lots of little buckets. The reality is that, you know, as investors, we have to look at, it's not a gift, it's not a grant. We're not getting a tax write-off on it immediately. Although if you like completely tank and go out of business, we might get a tax write-off 5 or 6 or 7 years from
now. We offer tax write-offs for donations. I just want to mention that, just if anybody's interested.
And we audit them.
Right.
Right.
So, you know, so when we look at addressing this problem, which for the last 6 years I've been struggling with all of the people in this room, we really have to look at how we go across the spectrum. And so I think it really, we will see that it needs to be a mix of private philanthropy, which is, you know, can be as simple as, you know, each of us, you know, throwing a dollar in the pot at a race to support TGen. Or it can be organized philanthropy like what LLS does, or Stand Up to Cancer does, or Susan B. Komen does, and so many more great organizations. But I think it also is going to take more organized philanthropy from families, family offices, private investors who recognize that you invest to make money. Don't get me wrong, okay? Investing is to make money. Everybody talks about social investing and the good of investing. And okay, let's be real. If you're investing in life sciences, you're doing social investing. Okay, but that doesn't mean that you're going to invest in companies that will not make money. You won't have any money to give away if you do that. Mm-hmm. But on the other side, I think we equally have to look at being philanthropic. And then conversely, there's a lot of families in Arizona that give away a lot of money philanthropically, and they're not investing. So what they're doing is they're getting these little projects started, but they're leaving somebody else to help them actually grow up. And I don't know about you, but it's a lot cheaper to raise a toddler than it is to put somebody through college.
You know, one of the things we didn't touch on is partnerships. We talked a little bit about philanthropy and investment, but what about partnerships? I've heard a lot of you today talk about the need for collaboration. We heard earlier this morning that the FDA is encouraging collaboration, so the regulatory agencies are becoming a little bit more amenable to allowing some of the safe harbors that are required for you to collaborate. So let's talk about partnerships, and we'll start with you, Jim.
Yeah, I think for us, and again, as I was mentioning before, I have a wonderful PowerPoint slide that shows this. It has puzzle pieces and where LLS, you know, as an example, as a nonprofit, kind of sits in the middle of all of these other players in this system, from you know, the academic researchers to small biotech to big pharma to the patients to the providers to the payers. And trying to create that sense of partnership and how you support innovation. And so that's, again, kind of a holistic view of it. But the other way, and as I was going to beat this horse to death, I guarantee you, this therapy acceleration program that we do, it is a partnership that we create with a small biotech company. We are investing as a nonprofit organization, and then we're helping to bring other resources to bear because we are, believe me, out there understanding what the best research is, the best technology, the best providers, the best hospitals to work with, and bringing all of those folks together. It's not a funding model necessarily from that standpoint, but it is helping to advance that innovation so that maybe it does become attractive and attracts that investment. We had a project that we've invested $8 million in, again, at a critical juncture along the way, that then attracted by design a much larger pharmaceutical company to come in and buy it. And from that $8 million investment that we made, we are now receiving a $28 million payoff from it that we're going to be plugging right back into our investment in research. So it's finding those partnership opportunities. We're a nonprofit partnering with small biotech. We partner with all sorts of other major research hospitals, universities, et cetera. Finding those people that can work together to elevate an idea, because again, for us as a mission-based organization, it's all about how do we get new treatments in the hands of patients. So I think, again, as Joan was saying, there's a lot of different buckets and a lot of different ways of looking at this, but how do you bring these people together to advance whatever it is that you're trying to advance?
Joan, any thoughts?
And I think, strategically, I know I've seen when we bring industry together with the patient advocate community. And I think there's a much deeper understanding that none of us can do this alone. We need your money, Jim, but we also need your patient insights.
Yes, and we've used those too. Right? I mean, on a legislative basis, I became a registered lobbyist with a little bit of help from Joan at one point to run a bill through the Arizona legislature. And it was all about, and again, partnership and collaboration, 23 different organizations, some nonprofit, some for-profit, all centered around patient care for the issue that we were talking about, and making that work. And that's a great example of that too. Bringing the patients into it as well. I know that's a lot of what you all focus on, just looking at some of your presentations. Keeping that at the core of it helps you kind of identify where those partnerships might arise from too.
And I see in the audience, and I'm not gonna name names, but see some of our, especially some of our major medical device companies here that have been wonderful strategic partners in working with some of these small companies, providing certain insights, research, in some cases access to laboratory or equipment to help them go further. I'm looking, Eric Miller, are you still in the room? There he is in the back of the room. PADT, one of our emerging growth companies here in Arizona, and actually across the Rocky Mountain Southwest, they're expanding. It has been at the forefront with 3D printing and putting in very expensive equipment into our incubators and other places to create those strategies, which they're not giving these companies cash, although little Bert has told me that some people at that company have been known to do that, but they're giving them the resources they couldn't otherwise afford and the talent they couldn't otherwise afford, and that's something that very often they'd never be able to pay for.
It's that infrastructure cost. Yep. So let's go back to the comment you made earlier about value. A lot of my clients are looking for me to help determine what the value of a business is. We call it a valuation. Uh-huh. It can be a financial valuation or a commercial valuation. Now, if value is benefit minus cost, and cost is the expense of infrastructure development, how do we create the kinds of metrics we need, both from a qualitative and a quantitative standpoint, to demonstrate value in the future? So let's start with you, Joan, and then we'll come back to you, Jim.
So I was an economist. That's how I was trained. And I found that I could build an economic model for anything. I also learned in my senior year, in my last class before graduation, that the minute you tell somebody what that model is, then other people's expectations change, and you will be wrong. I don't like to be wrong. So I stopped being an economist, but
try being an accountant.
Yeah. Well, you at least have more rules. But the reality is that when we're looking, especially when we're looking at early stage companies, there are a lot of things that as an investor I look at on an early stage company that you can't necessarily quantify. For instance, what is the management team? What is their track record in getting to the finish line? Are they going to, stick with it? Do they have their own skin in the game? Things like that I'm going to look at. I get in trouble sometimes with our universities. I love our student entrepreneurs. I really do. I'm not putting any money in a student entrepreneur company that doesn't have somebody helping that team that has not been there and done it, because those students don't have that experience. And somebody said, well, they're only asking for $500,000. And I got news for you. I had to work almost 2 decades to save my first $500,000 that I could invest in a company. So when somebody comes to me and says, well, it's only $500,000, as an angel investor, I'm like, whoa, you just showed me you don't respect the value of money. Because nobody gave me that $500,000. I had to earn it. And that's the way a lot of angel investors feel. And so, you know, when I was doing angel investing and I was investing in early stage companies, I wanted to know, did that company respect money and respect me as an investor? And did they have the what it took to go the distance, or were they going to bail the minute it got tough? Because I knew it was going to get tough.
Jim?
I don't know if I have a whole lot to add to this, because again, I look at value in a little bit of a different perspective as impact. And so it's not so much a financial, or maybe I'm the more qualitative side of this. And again, hearing some of the presentations this afternoon, thinking about the impact that they can have, again, in the patient population that they'll serve. And that's where, again, I come back to that value that you have as an organization, whether it's nonprofit, for-profit, startup, advanced, whatever it is what is that impact that you're making, the value you're creating within whomever you're serving, whatever that population might be. In here, it's mostly patients. And so, again, coming from that perspective of creating that value and what you're able to do to advance, you know, the mission of your organization and those patients that you serve, that's where I come back to. It doesn't help with the investment piece or the financial piece, but that's the way I look at it.
So, I mean, you have money. You invest in things. Tell me a little bit about the innovations that you've seen or have experience with that give you hope for the future.
Well, I see a lot of hope in I work in the cancer space, if there is such a thing, and see the investments that are made there. I get this question a lot. I spent the first 15 years of my career working in professional sports. And so people always ask me, okay, well, that was fun. You got to watch a lot of grown men run around in shorts, and that was your entire livelihood. So now you're working in trying to cure cancer. How has that had an impact on your outlook in, of course, dealing with a lot of patients and a lot of stories that don't turn out so well? And I always say that what I know now in my 6 years of having done this, I'm more hopeful than I've ever been that the investments that are being made, and I can speak a lot more to what LLS does than anybody else, but the investments that are being made are having an impact. And so again, looking from my point of view of where does that investment pay off, it is seeing something that gets advanced through to get in the hands of patients. We've had 40% of the drugs that have been approved by the FDA since the year 2000, 40% of the cancer drugs have been approved through blood cancer research. We do not have 40% of the cancer patients, I guarantee you. I don't know what the exact number is, but it's a far, far less than that. The investments that I see being made and that we develop through the money that we raise, and we're investing that with different, again, companies, universities, whoever that might be, is in that impact that they're making in saving lives. It's a great business to be in, I'll be honest with you, that when you see the investments that are being made and they're actually saving lives. And I can see that in, again, some of the presentations that you're making today, that it truly is where those investments bear the fruit. I don't think I answered your question, but I had a lot of fun talking about it. Thank you, Alex.
You're holding it close to the vest because you're going to give them money, right?
Yeah, I personally, I don't have any money to give. I apologize. I'm a nonprofit, but if any of you that are working in the cancer space, if you're interested, it has to be blood cancers as far as it concerns with me. Joan knows where to find me, and I can help you connect to the right people.
Connector. There you go. Joan, what do you think?
So I think, you know, there are tremendous things that we're seeing right now across a spectrum. You know, as investors, everybody would like to get that drug that's going to be the blockbuster, okay? You know, I want a pill that cures cancer. By the way, if somebody asks you to invest in a pill that cures cancer, that's probably not a good investment because they don't know what they're talking about. There is no such thing. But there are going to be blockbusters out there, and they're going to be long shots. And for private investors, they're going to have to get in earlier. With medical devices, health IT, some of those things, diagnostics, to some extent, you heard Dr. Barker talk about, you know, the challenges we face, but also the tremendous potential that we have in diagnostics. You know, those are things that I think a small, a person sitting in this audience that's a qualified investor could participate in. And those are opportunities. I'll tell you, once the drug or the medical device or the health IT thing starts to get into the stage where the big guys are coming in, the VCs are coming in, you're all locked out. You have missed the window. And then you won't have a chance to get back in again unless that company goes public. So, you know, one of the arguments for angel investing is, you know, if you blow money on Vegas or, you know, a vacation or whatever, because it gives you pleasure, that's cool. But for some of us, we're adrenaline junkies and we get the adrenaline from, you know, rolling $50 to $100 to $200 or $300,000 on a startup company. And that's what angels do. So we don't honor our angels. We don't give them as much respect very often as we need to on that. Because they worked hard for that money. They weren't, most of them, born with a silver spoon. And, you know, we're asking them to roll a pretty big roll of the dice on our companies. And they're not going to have perfect information. When, Alex, when you come to, you know, if I were to come to you as a VC and say, Alex, I'm going to put a $15 million investment in a phase three clinical trial, they're getting good data, this is probably 3 to 5 years out from going public, I think I've got a pretty good handle on this company, but I need you to do another eyeball to cover me so that when I go back to my LPs, they don't get mad at me if that phase three doesn't go through. That's your client, right?
That's right.
And
their standards are very high.
But at that point, we don't have perfect information, but we have a lot of information. Mm-hmm. Okay. An angel investor doesn't. Okay, you're going to go by your gut. You're going to trust the people. And it better be something you care about. And please, no matter how much you like the person, don't mortgage your house, take out a loan, or anything like that to invest in a startup company. That is not what angels do. Okay, it has to be money you can afford to lose, because 9 times out of 10 you will lose it.
So this has been a great discussion. Let's do some closing comments, and Jim, we'll start with you.
I would just say, and again, you know, the work that you are doing as either a startup company or as an angel investor, and just seeing a little bit of taste of that sitting here today, that's important work. And again, from a nonprofit person's point of view, it's that impact that you're able to make. And if you're able to prove that impact, show that impact, then that will attract the partnerships and the investment that you'll need to succeed. And don't ignore the nonprofit world too. I'll be perfectly honest with you. Our therapy acceleration program, I think I tried to say it at least 10 times, so I think I've reached my goal. It was something new when we started in 2007. And I think there are other organizations that are starting to do a similar effort. So don't overlook those as well. It might be a little more cumbersome, might be a little bit of a longer lead time. There might be a few, I don't know if there'll be more hoops to jump through than somebody giving you their money, I don't know, but don't dismiss that opportunity to maybe find a different bucket, as Joan said, to help advance your cause.
Joan, final comments?
I'm gonna get the last word when you guys get to get up, so I'm gonna let you close us out, Alex.
All right, great. So for what it's worth, we've heard a lot about investment, where to get the capital, what the expectations are from the market and the investment community. But the one thing we didn't talk about is what those standards are. So I want to take one last point here, and that's they're pretty high. The people who give you this money are not just expecting a return on investment, they are expecting a qualitative impact. To your point, Jim, they do want to see patients get cured, they want to see patients get helped. And if it's a company that's very large, they have an entire portfolio that they're trying to create a platform around. So there's complementary assets in that portfolio, and your component might be one really important piece. So the other thing that I would ask is that you keep it in context around the entire management of the disease and the patient experience. We heard a lot this afternoon from patients, and we really shouldn't discount that patient experience because a single solution may not be everything they need. So with that, I want to thank our panelists for their comments this afternoon, and I think that's the end of it. Thank you.